This May 6, 1968 footage from NASA shows a training vehicle used by Apollo 11 astronauts as they prepared to land the first man on the moon. In the clip, astronaut Neil Armstrong flies 200 feet above Ellington Air Force Base in Houston, Texas, in a mock lunar lander as it precariously wobbles in the air. An experienced pilot of the Lunar Lander Research Vehicle, Armstrong already had over 20 recorded flights under his belt. However, the video shows the control thrusters abruptly fail, shutting down aerodynamic maneuverability within seconds. The LLRV veers off course and plummets toward the ground before impacting in a fireball. Luckily, Armstrong comes down in a parachute, unharmed by the disaster thanks to his quick reaction to abort. LLRV Development. After his election, President John F. Kennedy had the difficult task of delivering on the promise of landing the first man on the moon. In charge of this task, NASA dealt with the how of the mission. One of the most challenging aspects they faced was actually landing humans on the moon, something both the United States and the USSR tried to solve for years. Given several training tools, the astronauts were most excited to use the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle and its follow-up, the Lunar Lander Training Vehicle. In 1961, NASA engineers and planners dedicated themselves to designing a machine that would complement the vertical landing trials accomplished by helicopters and ground-based simulators. That way, the astronauts could gain hands-on experience with a free-flying simulator closely resembling that of the landing module. They needed to overcome several obstacles, mainly replicating the moon's gravity, a sixth of that found on Earth. The machine needed to operate as close to the actual lunar module as possible in terms of controls, flight characteristics, and responsiveness. Bell Aerodynamics of Buffalo, New York, gained the contract for building the first LLRV, a fly-by-wire aircraft. Relying on an interface with three analog computers, the single pilot's movements would be converted to electronic signals transmitted by wire, which would then respond to commands. Perhaps unintentionally, the first LLRV helped develop digital fly-by-wire technology used in other subsequent aircraft. Two copies of the craft were built for NASA by Bell. Aside from lunar simulation, the machine functioned in a wide variety of tasks. The device neutralized aerodynamic forces, maintaining an engine thrust 5/6 the weight of the vehicle itself. This led to the most successful replication of zero-gravity conditions. The components and electronics needed to be as advanced and sophisticated as any other technology around in the 1960s. Armstrong would later speak about the vehicle, saying, quote, "The Eagle flew very much like the Lunar Landing Training Vehicle, which I had flown more than 30 times. I had made from 50 to 60 landings in the trainer, and the final trajectory I flew to the landing was very much like those flown in practice. That, of course, gave me a good deal of confidence, a comfortable familiarity." LLRV testing. On October 30th, 1964, North American X-15 hypersonic rocket pilot Joe Walker conducted the first LLRV flight. The flight lasted less than a minute, but the data acquired in that time was not only valuable, but also encouraging. Walker conducted two more flights that day. During this initial testing phase, his backup, Don Malik, as well as the rest of the test pilots, flew the LLRV 204 times. Each flight provided more and more feedback that went into modifications. In fact, because of the test flights, engineers at NASA developed lunar landing flight profiles in minute detail even before astronauts began training with the vehicle. The data collected also proved helpful in building a succeeding vehicle. Despite the desire to use a new model for training, time constraints and political pressure led NASA to use the LLRV as a trainer for astronauts while the new vehicle was still under development. Unfortunately, the first man to use the training vehicle, Joe Walker, never got to witness the endeavor. In 1966, his F-104 aircraft crashed mid-air against an XB-70 Valkyrie bomber. LLRV Risks. When looking closely at the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle, some have assessed accurately that it was not a perfect machine. While helpful and essential for the success of American space missions, later on, training exercises weren't any less dangerous. The astronauts would often refer to the vehicle as a flying testbed, and were well aware of the risks associated with it. Successfully piloting the machines was incredibly hard, but it also represented the difficulty astronauts faced in handling the lunar module in outer space. The equipment was involved with complicated controls that were new and strange. Armstrong himself later spoke out about the challenges, describing flying the vehicle as, quote, "the most difficult part from my perspective, and the one that gave me the most pause." Still, the NASA teams needed to train for the moon landing. They were required to acclimate to conditions, but every aspect of the mission, including planting the flag on the moon, had to be perfect. They also trained the survival skills extensively, since a returning flight could miss its mark, instead throwing an astronaut into the wilderness. Still, astronauts used the training vehicle. Armstrong's May 6th accident didn't deter him. After ejecting and narrowly avoiding the ball of flames, he simply returned to the office, finished out his workday, and went home as if nothing had happened. Before going on his space mission, he continued to fly with the practice simulator 12 times. Following the accident, the director of the Manned Space Flight Center, Robert L. Gilruth, ordered an investigation into the accident. Headed by Aircraft Operations Chief Joseph S. Algranti, who had also piloted the LLRV, the center's study concluded that the root of the problem lay in the loss of helium pressure. This pressure provoked the depletion of hydrogen peroxide, badly needed by the reserve altitude thrusters. Unfortunately, the LLRV's instruments had not shown the expected warning. Several engineers applied modifications that reduced the probability of a repeat accident. Testing resumed in October, 5 months after the occurrence. LLTV. Results from the test beds and further technological developments led developers to the LLTV, or Lunar Landing Training Vehicle. It was introduced as the new and improved model in 1967. This new vehicle enclosed a pilot on three sides, while the cockpit had a roof. This new cockpit replicated the view and enclosed space that astronauts would have in their actual lunar module. Still and all, the roof had to be removed soon after installation. The updated cockpit was interfering with the vehicle's ability to compensate for excessive yaw. This issue led to a crash, but thankfully test pilot Joe Algranti was able to eject safely and survive the ordeal. The LLTV suffered similar issues. Like its predecessor, it was a challenging vehicle to fly, perhaps even more so than the original. Gene Cernan, the commander for Apollo 17, stated, quote, "The LLTV was inherently less stable than the LM itself, and we also had to contend with gusts of wind that could cause problems." Two more LLRVs were built, and the LLTV saw an equally small production rollout, only three. In total, 15 American astronauts linked to Apollo missions flew either the LLRV or LLTV, or both. Most were either mission commanders or second-in-command. However, all who participated in the training with the machines had positive things to say. Armstrong would even credit the success of his moon landing on his training and use of the LLTV. He would go on to say, quote, "It was a contrary machine and a risky machine, but a very useful one."